morning. I greet you this morning in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Blessed Sunday to each and every one of you. This Sabbath day, may it be a day of rest, a day of worship for you, for your family, and this, our Reformed Church family. We're glad that you can join us wherever you are. May God bless you this day. Very grateful for the gifts that James Cobb brings to our service and music this morning. An original setting that he wrote of Psalm 23. I know it will be a blessing to you. Thank you for our choir, as always, for offering their voices. And today, a very special story to begin our Children in Worship series, which actually officially begins the last Sunday of this month, November 29. But today is just a preview, one of the stories that Miss Rebecca will tell. I know some of our younger children are missing the children's message. Clearly missing you being here sitting with me each week. But now, after every Sunday service, your children are welcome to remain with you or join you. Sit them down on the floor if you want, and they'll hear some of these beautiful stories of Jesus being told by Rebecca. Just a taste today of one of the stories, and next week, and then the official program will begin the last Sunday, which is actually the first Sunday of Advent. We begin the Christian story again with the advent of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Rebecca, and thank you, Bridget Gallagher, for countless hours you're putting to bringing this program to our children. So let us come now into God's presence and worship the Lord Jesus Christ. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth.
Amen.
God is the creator of the heavens and the earth.
God has made everything and given it to us.
Jesus is our Redeemer, our Savior, our friend.
Jesus has come to show us God's love and teaches us to love one another.
The Holy Spirit moves in us, brings us together, and guides us in life.
The Spirit reminds us that everything comes from God.
Let us share in all the good gifts of God.
Let us worship our God together as one.
Let us pray. Spirit of life, you've called us away from the way of the world into the ways of your righteousness. You call us to seek right living so that others may live, justice so that the marginalized and the oppressed may be lifted up and brought inside, mercy so that all may know your love. You guide us into the ways of peace so that all may thrive, so that one will not overpower another, but love will prevail. We gather this day to worship our God, who is love, you who are Savior, love incarnate. Grace us with the presence of your Holy Spirit today, and let our worship rise to you, drawing us closer to your throne of grace. In the name of Christ, our companion, our friend, our Savior, we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
We say we have no sin, the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is merciful, will forgive us and lead us to new life. We pray together. Eternal One, we confess that we are short-sighted. We put ourselves before others and are worried we don't have enough, while others around us go without. We call ourselves religious, but fail to be concerned for justice for our neighbors. We fear losing what we have, rather than living into God's ways and trusting in God's love and justice. Forgive us for our fears that hold us back, from our assumptions that cause us to not see the needs around us, and for the times we miss the mark. Call us back into your ways. In the name of Christ, our Redeemer and friend, we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
God is making all things new when we offer our lives to God, when we repent, when we turn back to God. We are given a fresh start, a new beginning, a chance to do love, justice, mercy, and to walk humbly before God. Know that in Christ our sins are forgiven, and then go and share this good news and seek justice for all. In Jesus' name, amen. One of my blessings I count as being able to bring you the Word of God this morning. I ascend these stairs with weak knees, but trusting in the Spirit to interpret these words that I offer. Apparently, some of you I heard forgot about daylight savings time and missed the service last week, even though the time change was actually 2 weeks ago. Not sure how that happened. But not to worry, you didn't miss worship because you can catch up. You can watch it anytime you want online. Call it a COVID silver lining if you wish. If you were with us last week and you were listening, as you ate your pancakes and waffles. Another COVID silver lining. Now I can go to church and eat breakfast at the same time. But if you were listening, you heard Jesus' parable, a very powerful parable about the 10 bridesmaids. Keep the oil in your lamps, keep them burning till the break of day. How did that go for you this week? Keep that flame burning. I had to keep mine burning just to stay warm. Yikes, seriously. Last week, you know, if you heard, I made a joke about my friends and family freezing in Michigan. It was 70 degrees there all week. And it was like 50 here, storming and windy and blowing. I had to bust out the long sleeves. The power went out, the internet didn't work, which meant schools couldn't meet online. The Veterans Day motorcade was canceled because of heavy rains and more roads being washed out. Speaking of that, thank you to all of our veterans, those who chose to serve God, country, and territory. We are very grateful for your lives. This is some year, though, 2020. Wow. I feel like it just, maybe the earth is just a little bit off a bit. But again, I remind us the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. God is with us. We hear another parable today, the parable of the talents. It's a follow-up to the bridesmaids, in case you missed it, in case you overslept, in case you had to go get some more syrup for your pancakes, in case you didn't understand the point that Jesus was making about the coming kingdom of God. This is Matthew 25, beginning of verse 14. For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward bringing 5 more talents, saying, Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one with 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, have what is yours. But his master replied, You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and then upon my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with 10 talents. For all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Grass withers and the flower fades, the word of the Lord endures forever. Amen. Well, that ending, that's pretty harsh. Pretty harsh. You did nothing with what I gave you. You worthless slave, worthless. Wow. Why did he not do anything with the one talent that he had been given? He said it. Verse 25, I was afraid. Fear. Fear shapes a lot of our decisions. And in this case, fear led to some bad decisions. Bad decisions lead to bad consequences. Outer darkness, weeping and gnashing of teeth. I bet he wishes he could do that one over. But it's hard to blame the guy, you know, when you read the story, hear the story, because it turns out he was right. The master is a harsh man. I mean, come on, the guy didn't lose anything. He gave the master back exactly what the master gave him. Here, take what is yours. I kept it safe for you. Nothing's changed. You see, the master was no further behind than when he started, and still, he calls him a worthless slave and throws him into the outer darkness. Yikes. Does that punishment really fit the crime? I mean, honestly, if Jesus is telling this as a parable of the kingdom and, you know, we servants and God master, God's not looking all that great. Like, I'm not thinking God's all that attractive. Why serve a tyrant? Why serve a master who wants more from you than what you are able to give? Why serve a master who isn't happy with the way things are? Here's your one talent. I didn't lose it. Nothing's changed. Can't you be happy with that? No. You might be happy with that status quo. But God, the master, is an audacious, loving, grace-filled, creative being of vast, infinite possibility. God does want more than you can give because God knows that you are able to give more. God isn't happy with the way things are because God knows things can be so much better. How does God know that? Think about it. God was in the garden. Remember? The very beginning. Remember the Garden of Eden. God remembers what it was like in the garden. How have we come so far from the garden? It's like a fading memory. Does anyone even remember the description of what that was like? Everything we needed was created for our enjoyment and for us in the garden, in paradise. But I was afraid. You know what a scarcity mindset is, right? Or a scarcity mentality? It's a fear that there will not be enough. It's always a focus on the short term. Someone with a scarcity mentality rarely makes an investment in a long-term future because they're afraid of what may happen or what may not happen. The best analogy that I have heard in regard to this, and I'll take it a little bit further, is about a tube of toothpaste. You know when you get a new tube of toothpaste and it's all packed full and you twist off that top for the first time and it comes off really nice and easy and you peel off the little tin foil that's there and you squeeze off for the first time this nice big line of fresh minty toothpaste all the way down and then you do a little fancy swirl at the end just like the commercial. And you brush your teeth with glee, white foam coming from your mouth and dripping down your chin. Oh yeah, there's an abundance of toothpaste. Then as time goes on, there's less and less toothpaste in the tube. Maybe you're a roller, you roll it up from the bottom until the last little bit comes out. Or maybe you're a flattener and you flatten it out until the last. Maybe you're a squeezer and you just kind of randomly squeeze the tube from wherever till you just can't squeeze out another drop. And you may not notice this, but As less and less toothpaste becomes available, I'll bet you ration it more and more. And every time you brush your teeth, there's a little less on the toothbrush because, you know what, there just may not be enough for the next time. Scarcity. I'm afraid it will run out. I'm afraid I won't be ready for tomorrow. I'm afraid I won't have what I need. I'm afraid that there's just not enough. I'm afraid. Fear. Fear leads to some very bad decisions. Bad decisions lead to bad consequences. Think about that in terms of how we live our lives. Especially now during COVID, when businesses are closing and economies are tanking, and we're all just trying to squeeze out as much as we can from this economy or from our situation or from our time or from our relationships, our interactions with other human beings. But could it be that the master really did have good reason to be angry? For what good is it if I give you these talents and you do nothing with them? I didn't create you. I didn't give you all of this, everything that you need, just so you could live your life in fear. What is God going to say to us on Judgment Day? I mean, that's the ultimate question Jesus is asking. God's going to say, "Well done, good and faithful servants. Enter into the joy of your master." Or, "Really? Really? That's what you did. That's how you chose to live your life and to use your talent." Sometimes I wonder if God wants more for us than we do for ourselves. But listen to this. I didn't realize this until I just worked on this passage this week. What did the first two servants say to the master? Verse 20, "You give me five talents, see, I have five more." Verse 22, the second one said, "You gave me two talents, see, I have two more." And I just noticed that in that little exchange, God didn't ask for those talents back, nor did they offer them. But the third guy, what does he say? Verse 25, "You gave me one talent. I was afraid. I hid it in the ground. Here, take what is yours." No. No. God doesn't want that. Could it be, could it possibly be that God gives us these talents because God wants us to enjoy them and to use them and to invest them and to prosper in them and to live into abundance? I hesitate to quote a motivational self-help author, but I like this quote. Wayne Dyer says, "Abundance is not something we acquire, it is something we tune into." It's all around us. It's already here. God has created all of us, and we have all been given at least one talent, one big talent, and you know what it is? It's called life. Life. What are we doing with it? "I was afraid, so I hid it in the ground." Fear. How do you get rid of a scarcity mindset? One thing you can do is just give thanks. Every day, give thanks for what you have. Don't think about what you don't have. Don't worry about what's not there. The first step is like we just sang, count your blessings. I know it's cliche, but it's true. Count your blessings. But when I thought about that, it also made me kind of sympathize with the guy who just got one talent, because he's there singing, "Count your blessings, name them one by one." Hey, that guy got two. At least that guy can finish the song. I can't even finish the song. And what about the guy? What about the guy who's got five? Now you envy him, and you're all thinking about, oh, that's not fair. He's over there singing, count your blessings, count them five by five, and you despise that guy. It's not fair. It reminded me of a story that I just saw about a guy named Muhammad Ikram. I don't know if I said his name right. It's a Pakistani kid who grew up, and he, for some reason, wanted to become a champion snooker player. And he did it. He realized that he had a talent for it and the drive, and he learned how to do it, and now he's a champion snooker player. So what, right? Who cares? I don't even know what snooker is, actually. I know it's played on a pool table, I think, right, with pool cues and stuff. So what's so great about that? He became a champion snooker player. What's so great about it is that Muhammad was born with no arms. So he learned to play and win with his chin. Plays snooker like that. His mom was quoted as saying, "We used to say that had he got arms, he would have been very happy. But now the whole world will be happy when they see him playing." Which is better, for one person to be happy or for the whole world to be happy? I thought that was such a great example of counting your blessings and focusing on what you have, not on the ones that you don't have. God, I don't have any arms, but thank you for my chin. So I wonder if just for today, and I'm preaching to myself right now, just take a moment and focus on what you have. Don't think about what you don't have. Forget about what you might wish you had. Don't think about that at all, just for today. And then maybe you'll want to do it again tomorrow. And maybe you'll do it again the day after that, and all of a sudden you'll realize I'm squeezing an abundance out of my life. And here's an idea. This is how you can remember how to do it, because I know you'll forget. As soon as you turn the service off, you'll forget. You'll start complaining. I'm just preaching myself again. When you go to brush your teeth, which, by the way, 4 out of 5 dentists recommend you should do every day, when you pick up that tube of toothpaste, look at it and think to yourself, is this tube half full or is it half empty? And when it runs out and you have rolled it and you have flattened it or you have squeezed every last bit of it, just trust that somehow there will be another tube somewhere for you. And then start counting them and naming them one by one. And then with your bright smile, resolve to go live out into God's beautiful garden, paradise. Not with fear, not with a scarcity mentality, but with an abundance of love and trust in the one who gives it to us all to begin with and who desires for us abundantly more than we could ever ask or even imagine. Yes. Here's to abundant life. In Jesus' name, amen. And for our offering today, we give out of our abundance a portion of what God has blessed us with. As we give, I also invite you to contemplate the words of this beloved Psalm 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will not fear evil. Fear is no way to live. Why, Lord? Because you are with me. And now receive this morning's offering. Thank you. Thank you, James. Thank you, Chanel. Thank you for the gift of that gorgeous melody and words of comfort. May these words continue to bring us comfort, each and every one of us, as we live this in this world that, although a little bit off its axis, is full of abundance of God's love, grace, and mercy. I invite you to spend a moment in silence, lifting your prayers to God Almighty, and together we will pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you.
And may an abundance of love, grace, and mercy be each and every one of yours now and forever. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
This is the story of the light. We use the Christ candle to help us tell this story. Once there was someone who said such amazing things and did such wonderful things that people began to follow him. but they didn't know who he was. So one day they simply had to ask him, and he said, "I am the light." Let us enjoy the light. Those who love the light can become one with the light. This is how your light can become one with the light. This is your light. This is your light. This is your light. Look how the light is growing. It all came from the one light, but the light is still the same. This is your light. This is your light. This is your light. Many have come to receive their light, and yet the one light is still the same. It's not any smaller. I wonder how so much light can come from the one light. There came a day when I received my light and became one with the light. Let us enjoy the light. There will come a time when our lights will change. They won't be just in one time and place anymore. This is how your light can change. even the light changed. The light that was in one time and one place changed. So that it could be with us always, in all time, all place. Even here and now, in this room.